Fark's annual trip north of the border would see Riley Knight in her Fark's Smash Beer Low Dollar Series debut, taking the Carl's P1 award in the number 9 car over at Motor Salt Racing, starting alongside her Zach Webster. Finally, a great qualifying effort from Webster and the 41 team after an abysmal start to the season for the Terra International Motorsports organization. Riley Knight is among many road course specialists in today's race. Knight, Mariano Zavala, and Osvaldo Ramirez will be competing in the Trans Am race here at Mosport tomorrow. So keep an eye on the Trans Am regulars today, but also keep an eye on hometown hero Zdane Quackenbush starting on the inside of row number 4, the only Canadian driver in the field, and the younger brother of John Quackenbush. Fark allows 36 cars to start the race on the road courses, but exactly 36 cars showed up. So everybody will be spared from making the trip all the way up to Mosport, only to be bumped out of the field in qualifying, which was fortunate for Kelly Splyson and Mason St. Martin, who both crashed on their qualifying laps, and so will start shotgun on the field. And we've got a couple more teams that fortunately found the funding to make it to Canada. John Burr, starting on the inside of row 14, found some last-minute sponsorship from Bonzi Buddy that allowed him to make the trip. And Keegan Mallory, bringing the Golden Apple Horse Seed sponsorship to AJ Young's team. Though I think Keegan Mallory is way, way above the level of the AJ Young team based on what we've seen from car 26 this season. So we'll have to see what he can do. Riley Knight's going to lead the field to the start, but Zach Webster gets a much better start than the 9, trying to outrun Knight into the first corner, a right-hander, so Knight's going to have the preferred line, but Webster powers around the outside, and Webster makes the outside work. He's going to grab the early lead. Riley Knight now falling into the clutches of Kevin Daly, replacing Ashley Tucker in that 64E Cola car for this week and Road America. Tucker will be back in the car at Road America, but Knight holds off the 64. In the meantime, it takes a few corners, but we've got an incident as David Lamar slides right up into Mason St. Martin in the 204 and kisses the wall. David Lamar apparently losing control of one of the slowest cars in the field. Lawrence Burr making his first start of the year is not going to make good use of it in the opening laps, getting into Bradley Carlisle, putting himself into the wall, and that's going to take the 61 out early on. Lawrence Burr, the fourth M&J car in the field, and I'm not sure why he drove past the pit lane. Maybe he thought the damage wasn't that bad, but he came in and bailed out of the car the following lap. So Lawrence Burr, one of the first casualties of the day. Zach Gott and Bradley Carlisle battling for position now, as you probably saw Chuck Johnson in the 46 bouncing off the wall back there. And now Carlisle and Gott door banging a little bit. Neither of them giving up early on, starting lap number 4 here, but Carlisle is going to have the upper hand over Zach Gott. Running on 4, Chuck Johnson just behind that battle. There he goes, right into the wall. Pretty big hit to the left side of the 46, but Johnson is going to keep going. After all the bad luck that Chuck Johnson and the 46 team have had this year, a little contact with the wall should be no big deal. Zach Webster runs right off the road in the final corner. Kevin Daly says, "Thank you very much, I'll be taking the lead now." Kevin Daly trying to pull away as Zach Webster seems to have lost the handling on that car right in the opening laps, and if that's the case as he goes right off, then that's not going to bode well for the 41 team after a very promising start to the weekend, winning the pole, being very fast overall, but hopefully Zach Webster can get it back together. Venezuelan driver Mariano Zavala, in his return to the Fark Smash Beer Low Dollar Series, currently runs in third on lap number 5. Riley Knight and Trek Togger trying to chase him down as Zavala tries to catch Webster and his teammate Kevin Daly. Zavala taking over the 62 at M&J, the same car that won at Elko last week with Mark Thompson behind the wheel. Zach Webster in second is the highest running series regular, and then If you want to find the next series regular, you're going to have to go all the way back to 9th place, Gio Arias. So we've got a cluster of series regulars back here. Stanley Parsons in 10th and Lev Azarov in 11th place. They're trying to catch the 86, but Riley Knight from 4th place is going to go off the road. And now she's going to drop all the way back to 7th. There go David Hetzel and Dan Francis Jr. as Riley Knight tries to get it back together and drop all the way back to this battle. Keegan Mallory and Kelly Splyson are starting to work their way through the field. Mallory 27th and Splyson 26th. Keegan Mallory looking to punch above his weight, driving the AJ Young car, which has struggled for all of 2016 so far, routinely failing to qualify for races, and when it has failed to qualify, it's been running right at the back. I said in the pre-race, Keegan Mallory is well above the level of the AJ Young team, but sometimes you gotta take what you can get. Kevin Monroe runs off the road right in front of Jim Kidd. The two get together and almost take each other out. Look out, Jim Kidd. Looked like he may have tried to take Kevin Monroe out there, but thought better of it. And you probably saw the bright pink car of Truman Ellison in the pit lane. Truman Ellison brought that car in and dropped out. No big surprise from Truman Ellison and the 03 team. I'm surprised they were able to make it to Mosport. But running right behind Kidd and Monroe, you see Anthony Griffith, who surprisingly qualified way down in the field, but is getting a little aggressive with Riley Durbin trying to make his way through the field. Riley Durbin moved over and crowded the 07 a little bit. Looked like he didn't appreciate that one bit. And now heading into the hairpin, look back there, there's a crash. We got Kelly Splyson and Monica Rook tangling. They go way off into the sand pit, but fortunately, we stay green. Those guys are going to get their cars back going. The leaders encounter David Lamar in the 40, who went off in the first few corners and is now going a lap down. Kevin Daly took to the grass to get by the 40, but now Zach Webster is stuck behind Lamar. Lamar driving for the Stan Coleman team. Very slowly for the Stan Coleman team, as he's going to hold up Zach Webster all the way down the backstretch. And here comes Mariano Zavala licking his chops, looking to get second. Webster finally let go by the 40. Is Zavala gonna be able to get by? No, he's gonna check up and get stuck behind the 40 as well. So Zavala saw an opportunity, but that opportunity goes away, as he's now held up by David Lamar, one of the slowest cars on the track. And look at all those positions that Mariano Zavala is losing thanks to Lamar's impeding. Riley Knight getting stuck behind Zavala and Lamar now. Zavala now looking to the left side. He's gonna get by. Riley Knight gonna get by as well. So that was quite an ordeal for some of our leaders. But now Kevin Daly's gonna get stuck in lapped traffic as he gets held up behind the 00 of Troy Peterson. Zach Webster sees this as a chance to come back after the 64. Here he comes, making up a ton of time. And now Zach Webster and Kevin Daly are gonna get right back to where they left off as Daly finally gets by the 00, while Zach Webster has no trouble with him at all, and it looks like they're not going to have any trouble getting past the 100 of Tom Brayton either. But Kevin Daly goes off, heading into the hairpin, lap number 10. Daly loses control of the car, and he's going to give up the lead to Zach Webster. Webster back out in front, starting on the outside row and sniping Riley Knight at the very start. Daly's gonna drop a few more positions as he now settles in behind Dan Francis Jr. in the 83 car. Trek Togger goes off from third place. He gets together with Dave Hetzel. Both of them go into the wall, heading into the final corner right at the entrance to the pit lane. So this is gonna give Kevin Daly a chance to make up a couple of spots as Hetzel and Togger get back going again. They both feel like they don't have to pit, but you see the yellow flag is out. Kevin Daly stopped on the front stretch, so never mind about that. Kevin Daly, the motor lets go on car 64, and he's going to come to a stop in the middle of the front stretch. That's going to bring out our first caution, 11 laps in. I'm kind of surprised that it took this long for the first caution to come out, but now the leaders have an opportunity to make their first pit stops of the day. Disregard the 89 of Kira Smith. She went a lap down, but Zach Webster is going to remain in the lead after pit stops. Kira Smith restarting on the tail end of the lead lap, but it's not like she's going to be able to do much with that. Kira Smith, way off the pace, gets swamped on the restart by the much faster cars. Kira Smith has demonstrated quite a lack of pace in her foray into FARC racing, and a lack of much of an idea what she's doing at all, as she now holds up the 28 of Zidane Quackenbush, the only Canadian driver in the field, as I mentioned earlier. That's probably not going to go over well with the home crowd, but Quackenbush makes quick work of her anyway. But Dan Francis Jr. now in trouble. Francis restarted in third place, but now he's going to come to a stop after the hairpin. That's going to bring out our second caution on lap number 16. We only have a few takers on pit road this time by, a little over a dozen cars, led by Gio Arias, who pits from 16th place. None of the leaders pitted. Zach Webster continues to lead the race after the restart. Working lap number 19 of 51 now. Mariano Zavala settling back into second place. And now Zavala comes after Webster, coming down the backstretch. The 62's got a little more straight line speed than the 41. And Mariano Zavala seals the deal, running off the road a little bit, but he's going to keep Webster behind him. That puts Mariano Zavala in the race lead, as much as it looks like he's trying to throw it away. Zavala, not known for being the most conservative driver around, but his attempts to go off the road are to no avail. Kelly Splicen is in more trouble as she's trying to recover from tangling with Monica Rook. She's going to come to a stop right in the middle of turn one, bringing out caution number three. Coming back to the caution, Chuck Johnson is going to have some issues and come to a stop right after the hairpin. So more abysmal luck for the 46 team. The battle off pit road is won by Bob Steffens after a very quick stop by the number 7 team. Mariano Zavala is going to have to settle for second. Bradley Carlisle third. Lev Azarov coming out fourth. So top five is going to get shuffled a little bit as Zach Webster now finds himself back in fifth place. Billy Bob Childers, after cracking the top 10 prior to halfway, is going to drop out of the race, trying to catch back up to the field. In the meantime, Bob Steffens leads over Mariano Zavala on the restart. He jumps out to about a four-car length lead, but we're going to have to see if he's going to be able to hold that as the top two try to get away from the rest of the field. But Mariano Zavala is going to catch right back up, put a bit of pressure on Bob Steffens. Steffens almost goes off the road. You also saw Lev Azarov go off the road in the final corner. I think he may have smacked the wall with the left side of that car. Zach Webster now coming back after Bob Steffens. Webster going off the road once again, but it looks like he's going to keep up the momentum and complete the pass on Bob Steffens. So that puts Zavala and Webster back running 1-2. But Webster doesn't want to be number two in this relationship, especially not after finally getting a good car this year, pounding the back of Mariano Zavala. Can't quite get him this time, but Webster and Zavala are putting on a good show on their own, even though they're running away from the field. But the caution comes out once again. Zavala's teammate, Kevin Monroe, once again getting together with Jim Kidd. sending the 63 car spinning across the track. Now that was just a harmless single car spin. I'm not sure why that brought out the caution, but we finally get a caution after an actual incident instead of a car stalling on the track for a mechanical failure. So I'd say it's been a pretty clean race so far. Good job by the men and women of FARC for mostly keeping it together on a road course, a very different challenge than they're used to. No takers on pit road among the leaders, so Mariano Zavala and Zach Webster get right back to their battle after the restart. And there you see Riley Knight making her way back up to third place after losing the lead at the start and a couple of other mishaps. John Burr, car 54, has picked his way into the top 20. We didn't think he'd make it to Canada at all, but now he's going to go out of the race after getting together with Dave Hetzel. Poor John Burr just can't seem to catch a break. He's been qualifying for very well for some of these races this year, but then he just gets taken out. Battle for the lead. Zach Webster and Mariano Zavala, Riley Knight, still right there in the mix. Whatever adjustments the 9 crew has made to that car, it's paid off. Webster takes control of the lead down the backstretch as Riley Knight creeps in on the 62, much like how they will probably be going head-to-head in the Trans Am race tomorrow, trying to get some seat time for that race in a big way. Checking back in on Keegan Mallory, who has now made his way up to 17th, and if we get a bit more attrition in this race, he could challenge for a top 15 in the AJ Young car. Never thought I'd be saying that this year about the 26 team. He's trying to hold off Gio Arias in the 86, who has had a couple mishaps and has made some pit stops to perform some repairs. And you see that car back there missing its front end. That is David Hetzel. Keegan Mallory running ahead of the man who took him under his wing on a few occasions in the TM ranks. Another driver punching above his weight is Osvaldo Ramirez in the Laser Motorsports number 91. Laser Motorsports has also struggled for results this season, except for today, where Osvaldo Ramirez is challenging for a top 15 with just under 20 laps to go, and currently doing a good job at trying to hold off his former boss. Ramirez drove for M&J Racing in the Smash Beer Low Dollar Series a few years back, and last year in the FARC Super Series. Anthony Griffith has finally started to make his way forward. He is up to 11th, leading Todd Stater, who up until the end of the race at Elko was the points leader. He then lost that to Kenny George III. Bob Steffens has 4th. Lev Azarov wants it, and he's going to make a move down the right side of the 7. Heading into the hairpin, Steffens helps him out a little bit by going off the road. Azarov says, "Thank you very much, I'll be taking that position." Azarov showing off that road course experience by moving up to 4th place in the Rus Autosport 82. Zidane Quackenbush continues to run very respectably, up to 7th place in the 28 car. Quackenbush, the 15-year-old brother of TM Lights driver John Quackenbush, has probably had this race circled on his calendar ever since he learned he was going to be the driver of this 28 car in 2016. Quackenbush previously grabbed back-to-back 11th place finishes at Daytona, where he made his FARC debut, and now it looks like he's going to try to come after the 8 of Bradley Carlisle after Carlisle ran off the road, allowing Quackenbush to gain a little time on him. Zach Gott, Quackenbush's Gravity Racing teammate, is not faring so well. He had a pit a few laps ago for a cut tire and lost a lap. He is now down to 20th place, and it looks like he is struggling a little bit with the handling of that 71 car. Mariano Zavala gets trapped behind the double zero of Troy Peterson. He is going to lose second place to Riley Knight. This green flag run has gone on long enough to where the leaders are going to start to encounter the slow cars, and once again, the lapped cars are going to be an ordeal to get around. although Zach Webster and Riley Knight sure didn't have any trouble. Mason St. Martin in the 204 is going to go up in smoke. He was running all the way back in 25th place, one of the slower cars on the track. This is the second car for the Patrick Carpino team. Carpino did not bring his own number 200 car to this race, only bringing a car for Mason St. Martin. Lev Azarov now going off the track in the hairpin from fourth place. He's going to lose fourth to Bob Steffens, but he's going to try to get back on the track to preserve fifth place from Bradley Carlisle. Carlisle coming after the 82 car. Side by side down the backstretch, Azarov and Carlisle. Neither driver giving up. Who's going to give? It looks like Carlisle's going to have the upper hand here. Azarov lets him go off the exit of that corner. Looks like he's still trying to come to grips with the new unwanted adjustments to the back end of that 82 car. The lapped cars continue to cause headaches for the leaders as David Labar takes Dan Lecklater off the road from 12th place. And it looks like that's going to bring out the caution. I'm not sure why. We've had a couple incidents in that corner already that haven't brought out the caution. Then again, the field has gotten quite spread out since that last restart, and we are coming up on 10 laps to go, aren't we? Don't you think it's time for a break? I think it's time for a break. Dan Lecklater, I'm sure, is going to be wanting a break as he limps that 10 car back around the track. Riley Knight, coming to the restart, is going to drop out with transmission problems. She has lost third and fourth gear. So, mechanical gremlins bite the 9 car after a great run. A couple mishaps along the way, but she has been clawing her way back through the field. But now she is going to drop out. Riley Durbin restarted as the first car one lap down in between leader Zach Webster and second place Mariano Zavala. I'm sure Zavala doesn't appreciate Durbin getting the way, but Webster has got to be loving what he's seeing in his mirror right now as he tries to make it around for these final 10 laps, but Webster slows! 7 laps to go, Zach Webster has slowed down, and he is showing no signs of getting that car refired. Coming into turn 2, Webster is going to crawl to a halt after dominating this race. The caution is going to fly once again. Webster in a very dangerous position as Gio Arias just demonstrated smashing right into the back of the 41 car, running wide through the bend. Arias not really left with too many options. Fortunately, both drivers climb out in what was easily the most violent incident of the day. But now Mariano Zavala takes over the lead once again. And Zach Webster, his biggest competition, is now out of the way. Riley Durbin, unable to get by the 62 car. He's still going to be trapped a lap down, but now Mariano Zavala is going to try to take advantage of the 38 getting in the way. He gets a big start as Durbin impedes Lev Azarov and Bob Steffens. Azarov going for second place around the outside of the 7. What I previously said was an unwanted adjustment now may become an advantage for the 82. Riley Durbin runs off the road. Azarov's going to get by Durbin. You see the spoilers kicked up on the right side of that 82 car that may help him out, add a little downforce. But Durbin still getting in the way. Azarov could not complete the pass on the 38. And Azarov's not going to have a whole lot of time left to screw around like this. Zdane Quackenbush running off the road, trying to get around Bob Steffens. Steffens is going to try to hang on to third place, but Quackenbush gaining a couple more positions. He's going to try to end the day with a top 5 finish. Riley Durbin now playing games with the race leader. Durbin trying to get around him, trying to get a lead lap finish. That's allowing Lev Azarov to catch up as Mariano Zavala takes the white flag. Zavala and Azarov both looking for their first career win in the FARC Smash Beer Low Dollar Series. Zavala's previous best finish was 2 second place finishes in a row to Taylor Brillen on a couple of super speedways in 2013. But now Mariano Zavala comes across the line to take his first win and the second win in a row for the M&J Racing number 62. Lev Azarov is going to have to settle for second place. Bob Steffens, third place. Zidane Quackenbush, the only Canadian in the field, fourth. Kenny George broke into the fifth spot on that final restart, trying to open up his points lead over Todd Stater a little bit more. Bradley Carlisle and Jim Kidd, despite going off the road a couple times, sixth and seventh. Billy Ray Smith Thompson comes home in eighth place. Kevin Monroe, after a less than stellar qualifying effort, brings it home ninth. Todd Stater, 10th. 14 cars finished on the lead lap. David Hetzel was the last of them, missing his front end. But looking back through the field, we've got several teams who punched well above their weight. Of course, some of that was influenced by the attrition. But for teams like Osvaldo Ramirez, Tom Brayton, David Lamar, and Troy Peterson, those top 20 finishes are well worth celebrating. And how about a shout out to Kira Smith in the 89, the slowest of the Terra International cars, but she was the only one of them who finished. And now looking at the point standings, Kenny George does open up his lead to 22 points over Todd Stater, Bob Steffens, and Lev Azarov, third and fourth. It's been a pretty good start to the season for the Pearson Sweeney boys, Bradley Carlisle and Billy Ray Smith Thompson, both of them solidly in the top 10 in the standings. And looking back a bit further, we're getting into the guys who, despite not running all of the races so far, they have done well enough in their races to remain in the top 20. Guys like Riley Durbin, Jason Bates, and Kenny Brillen. Mark Thompson is still 18th thanks to his win at Elko. Zidane Quackenbush makes his way up into the top 20 with his fourth place finish. And Billy Bob Childers rounds out the top 20. So that puts both of the Sergio Power cars in the top 20. The next challenge for the FARC Smash Beer Low Dollar Series will be another road course, Road America in Elkhart Lake, Wisconsin, which at 4 miles is the longest track on the calendar. And you'll be able to catch all the highlights from Road America right here on the FARC Racing Network.